Hello, my name is Chris Eccleston, and today I'm going to tell you the story of Sinbad. Sinbad is an adventurer who travels far and wide, getting up to all manner of amazing exploits, some of which you won't believe. So sit back, relax, and let me tell you the story of Sinbad. Sinbad wanted to be a sailor. Ever since he'd been a small boy, he'd been enchanted by one thing and one thing alone, the sea. He'd go down to the sea every day, absolutely every day without fail. Sometimes he'd swim, sometimes he'd simply sit and stare for hours on end until it was time to return home. But mostly, Sinbad loved to go down to the harbour and be amongst the ships. Ships were Sinbad's passion. You see, he loved ships. In fact, some of his friends thought he was a bit of a ship anorak. One morning, Sinbad was sat on the quayside, making notes in his book. Okay, let's see. Oh, an Ottoman 457 clipper, I'd say. What, 90-footer? 90-footer, yep. That's going in the book. She's a beauty. Look at the mast work on that. Someone's put love into that mast. As he was finishing the last entry of the morning, an Arabian Seahorse 2000 with automatic sail flaps and customised stern, he noticed his father walking towards him, head down. Uh-oh, thought Sinbad. I'm in for another telling off. What have I not done now? For once, though, Sinbad was wrong. His father raised his head slowly, looked Sinbad straight in the eye and said, "Son, there's something I've got to tell you, and it won't be easy." Sinbad looked at his dad with genuine concern, only momentarily distracted by the sight of a Nineveh Sport, one of the best 70-foot spy ships on the market, with the new raised wheelhouse just nudging into view around the bay. His dad continued, "You remember that little investment I told you about? The area of Oasis that they were going to build a new multi-story market on? Well, I'm afraid it's collapsed." Sinbad was alarmed. "Was anyone hurt?" he asked. "No, you daft apeth. The investment has collapsed. We've lost everything." Turns out it wasn't quite an oasis after all. More a swamp.
"A swamp?" cried Sinbad. But how did...
"Oh, it's easy for you to say that," said his father. "But I thought the oasis was watertight. I presumed I... He faltered. "Oh, I don't know. That was going to be my dream oasis. Now, well, it's all a bit of a blur." Sinbad shook his head in disbelief. "There is one thing left, though, for what it's worth," said his dad dejectedly. "I've still got your birthday present."
Sinbad peered at his dad and smiled. Of course. In all the confusion, he'd forgotten what day tomorrow was going to be. His birthday.
"You see, son," said Sinbad's father, "I've decided to pack up and go and live in a commune in the mountains, making my own organic cheese. Well, you can have your birthday present a day early. I left it with Salty, the harbour master." And with that, Sinbad's dad was gone.
What an amazing morning, thought Sinbad to himself. A Nineveh Sport, with a raised wheelhouse. How often do you see that?
And he took himself off to see Salty, the harbour master. "Sign here, and here, and initial there," said Salty. Sinbad signed the form and waited for Salty to hand him his present. But nothing happened.
"Well?" said Sinbad.
"Well, what?" said Salty.
"Well, aren't you going to nip in the back and lug my present in?" said Sinbad.
Salty smiled. "Oh, it'd take a better man than me to lug your present. It's in the harbour, Bay 33.
Sinbad was somewhat bemused. Why hadn't anyone even had the courtesy to bring his present in from outside?
He wandered down to Bay 33.
Maybe it was because he was a day early? Yeah, that must have been it. He was a day early. He walked past the ships to Bay 33, stopping only if he saw a ship that interested him.
3.5 hours later, he was at Bay 33.
There, sat in all her glory, was Sinbad's present. It wasn't a Nintendo DS. It wasn't some new clothes. It wasn't even an iTunes token. Can you guess what it was? That's right. It was a ship. Sinbad's jaw dropped to the floor and broke into 1,000 tiny pieces. "Oh my giddly goodness," he mumbled. "A Gulf Boy 2.0, the Mach 6 version, with alloy masts and go faster sails. I don't believe it."
He sat down and stared. Then he ran aboard and began to play with as many buttons as he could find, pressing this, pulling that, opening the other.
It was fantastic.
How he wished he could thank his dad now, but, well, he was already off making cheese. Sinbad decided to sit and think. He sat on his boat and stared out to sea. He thought and he thought and he thought.
Eventually, he'd decided. He knew what he was going to do. He was going to go to sea. By the end of the day, he'd got himself a crew of five. The Gulf Boy couldn't fit many, and he was off. Sinbad went to sea. Let's hear some music now, all about Sinbad's journey to sea. See if you can hear the roaring waves of the great ocean as Sinbad's boat cuts a dash through the big blue sea. Wow, wasn't that amazing music? Could you hear the ship gliding across the sea? Yeah, I think I could too. While you were listening to that, Sinbad was busy sailing. He sailed for 7 days, 7 long days. He and his small crew were tired. Suddenly though, a week into his journey, he noticed something interesting. Something very interesting indeed. "Oh my word," he said. "That's a Caspian B4. I haven't seen one of them since the Muscat Regatta. It must be at least 100 feet long." Then, just to the right of that, he saw something equally interesting, shall we say. It appeared to be an island. Not a very big island, to be fair. It must have been only about, 50 feet in diameter? Not great for mooring, it has to be said, but, it'd be a welcome stop for a tired crew. They landed on the island around dusk. Bosun overboard sang sea shanties, but with lots of the words missing. His memory wasn't all it had once been. Young Abel, the one-legged seaman, danced traditional one-legged dances. Poisonous Pete, the cook, told his famous fishy tales, which he'd been collecting all his life. Each one starting with the words, "Now, here's a fishy tale and a half." But best of all, Sinbad entertained the crew with his photos from last year's Ship Spotters Convention, at which he'd been asked to give a talk entitled "Tea Clippers Are My Life." When the motley crew could take it no longer, Abel and Overboard were dispatched to get firewood so that Poisonous Pete could make supper. Sinbad had brought the remains of a barrel of rum with him, which he served up to each of the crew with a sprig of jojoba on the side. There was nothing a sailor liked more than jojoba and a barrel of rum. Just then, though, a rather curious thing happened. Abel and Overboard had just begun lighting a fire when, when a sinister trembling noise could be heard. Like that, a real noise. Can you hear it? Sinbad looked around. The island appeared to be shivering. It was like someone had taken a bad picture of it and all the edges were blurred. And it was getting worse. "Hang on a minute," said Abel, the seaman. "The fire's rising." They all looked at the fire. True enough, it was rising, higher and higher. "In fact, come to think of it," said Bosun Overboard, "so are we." Sinbad looked to the edge of the island. The water was gushing away in a huge cascade, and the island was indeed rising.
"Now that's a fishy tale and a half," said Poisonous Pete.
"Not now, PP," said Sinbad. "The last thing we want is a story."
"No," replied Pete, "no, that's a fishy tail and a half."
The crew looked round to see a fishy's tail that was as big as several ships, and it was coming right towards them. You see, the 50-foot-long island was not an island after all. I think you've guessed, haven't you? It was the back of a giant fish, a giant sleeping fish, which had just been awakened by the fire on its scales. Now it was on the warpath, ready to flip the unwelcome guests from its back.
"Run for your lives!"
shouted Sinbad, as the shadow of the enormous tail fin turned everything as dark as night. But it was too late.
Ka-splash! The whack!
The tail fin crashed down and swept the stunned and staggered sailors off the fish's back. All of them went piling into the deep, dark sea. Sinbad found himself completely underwater. He was sinking, sinking fast. He began to try to remember his prayers, but just at that point, he saw the rum barrel floating upwards past him. He grabbed it with both hands and clung on for all he was worth. Unbeknownst to him, though, The barrel had been at the bottom of the sea once already, forced deep into the ocean when the fish hit out with its tail. It was now on its way back up, propelled with the vacuum of pressure created by the huge fish tail.
Oh!
Cried Sinbad as he shot above the surface of the water and high into the air. He'd never felt anything like this before. He was going up so high and so fast that his soaking wet clothes were actually drying off. But, as you well know, what goes up must come down. Sinbad eventually reached high up in the sky, so high that he quickly grabbed a piece of cloud to eat. He was disappointed it didn't taste anything like candy floss. He hovered for a moment in midair, bemoaning the taste of the cumulonimbus, before beginning to fall. And fall, and fall, gulped Sinbad, before letting out another long, ah! Shall we hear a piece of music now, all about swimming underwater? See if you can imagine Sinbad wibbling.
Ford Galaxy of Stories on Classic FM. Every journey has a happy ending in the Ford Galaxy.
Storytime with Ford Galaxy.
The weatherman said blue skies, so the Alley family were off to the beach. Mr. Alley, the woodcutter, piled tinder in the Galaxy's oversized boot.
Smell kebabs already, smiled Mrs. Alley, as she flipped down a seat or three to stow the cool box.
Then came the kids with their power kites, travelling light as usual. Later, at the beach, as a storm drowned the fire and swept the kites far out to sea, they put the Galaxy in fully flat mode. Safe inside, the Alley family sat cross-legged, sharing crisps and memories of other rainy days. And so ends our tale of Alley's barbecue and the many seats.
Ford Galaxy of Stories on Classic FM. Every journey has a happy ending in the Ford Galaxy.
Hello, my name is Chris Eccleston, and I was halfway through telling you what happened to Sinbad the Sailor. Well, the next morning, Sinbad awoke. He was glad he awoke, actually, because he'd been having a rather weird dream about giant fish. In his dream, it was all rather silly, actually, so best not go into it. Safe to say, it involved landing on an island that turned out to be a fish. Very silly indeed. Sinbad opened his eyes and let out a weary yawn. Told you. He stretched his arms out wide, shook his head a little for luck, and decided to step out of bed. Kadunk. That was the sound of Sinbad falling out of a palm tree. He stood up and looked around him. Instantly, it came back to him. It hadn't been a dream. There really was a giant fish, and he really had been blown right up into the air, holding onto nothing but a barrel for dear life. And then, that's right, he'd landed in a huge clump of palm trees, something which had obviously scared him so much he'd passed out. So where was his crew? Presumably, they'd not survived. Abel Seaman was no longer. Abel, that is. Poisonous Pete had cooked his last monstrous meal, and Bosun Overboard had finally, lived up to his name. He began to walk round the island on which he'd landed. It was clearly a huge place. Actually, when I say place, I mean place. Obviously, not place. He wasn't on a giant fish again or anything like that. This was a proper big island. He wandered round the edge of the island, determined to find some signs of life. Eventually, after rounding a rather large, rocky promontory, which took some doing, I can tell you, he began to shout and scream for joy. There, in the next bay, he found himself looking down on a thriving, teeming harbour filled with people going about their business. Fantastic, he shouted. And if I'm not mistaken, that's the Portermaster 665, which comes with real silk rigging and self-supporting ballasts. Cool. He trudged wearily down to the harbour. As he got closer, he realised that the harbour was not just teeming with life, but that something special was going on. There was bunting all around and crowds of folk were lining the streets. Bands were playing, drinks were flowing, street hawkers were selling those little flags for people to wave. Flags which all bore a picture of a man in a crown. Sinbad quickly worked out that it must have been the king's birthday celebration or something. He wandered down to the harbour, forgetting that he was wearing nothing but the rum barrel which had saved his life. As he neared the quayside, he could see an amazing sight. There, moored to the docks, was the king's ship, the SS Keith. Sinbad had never seen a ship like it. Oh my giddly goodness, he said in astonishment, and oblivious to everything around him, he marched right up to it. Instantly, a band of the king's guards ran up and surrounded him. Seeing the commotion, the king came over.
Hi, nice to meet you. What a lovely checkout. Now, what exactly do you do? Said the king.
Then he remembered. It was Tuesday. Opening the supermarket was tomorrow. He quickly corrected himself.
I say, what is the meaning of this?
He barked. Sinbad was rudely plucked from his reverie.
What?
Oh, sorry, Your Majesty, he said respectfully. I was just overwhelmed by your ship. I wanted to get a closer look. The king was touched.
Oh, yes, the SS Keith. Isn't she a beauty?
Sinbad agreed. Oh, she is, Your Majesty, she is. Built on the same chassis as a Arabian Seahorse 7000, if I'm not mistaken. Only with a completely customised hold.
Oh, yeah, you've had the cabins double-sealed, I see.
And the main brain unspliced, always wise. Can I ask, where did you have those masts French-polished? The king looked at Sinbad in bewilderment.
France? He said, amazed.
Good move, countered Sinbad. Well, they invented it, didn't they? Still the best, oh yeah. This is a lovely piece of sea kit, no mistake. Okay, see you then, Your Highness. And with that, Sinbad moved to go.
Young man, stay there, barked the king. How do you come to know so much about ships?
Sinbad smiled. He loved the easy ones. Well, Your Majesty, ships are my life. For a good 20 years now, I've studied them, watched them, drawn them, noted them, sketched them, written my version of Top Trumps with them. Not many takers on that one, it's fair to say. And, well, generally, adored them. I can tell you virtually any ship in the known world up to a distance of 2 or 3 miles. The king was amazed.
Okay, big talker. What's that one over there? He snapped.
Sinbad giggled. Too easy, Your Majesty. That's a Black Sea Camel. So-called because its hold was adapted for increased water rations, allowing for a maximum voyage time of 7 months. Nice leather wheel cover, too. The king tried again.
And that one, beyond the harbour.
Easy, that's an Aden 1600. 3 times the sail capacity of the previous Aden 1500, and also twice as light. It caused a sensation at the Cairo Boat Fair in 56, because it was the first boat in its class to do 0 to 3 knots in less than 6 days. Woodwork to die for.
Okay,
the king thought, determined to come up with a corker.
The one with the black sails, right out at sea.
Sinbad squinted. The crowd hushed. Sinbad faltered.
It's the,
He stopped. No, it's not, he continued. It's... Yes, it is. It's a Surt C6. Nice boat. Fast. 0 to 5 knots in just 4 days, favoured by... Sinbad paused.
Go on, said the king.
Well, favoured by pirates, actually. Usually, pirates remove all the glass from the windows and use the spaces as cannon holes. The king looked concerned, but kept calm.
And has this one had its windows removed?
He questioned. Sinbad squinted a little more.
Hang on a minute, he strained.
Yes. Immediately the king called his guards and put the port on high alert. People ran from the streets and back to their homes. The Navy launched a fleet of their finest ships, B-19s actually, with the brand new patent alloy anchors, and pretty soon, the pirate threat was no more.
What is your name, O Anorak One? Said the King.
Sinbad, sir, Sinbad the Sailor.
If you are a sailor, sir, then where is your boat?
Continued the King. I'm wearing it, sire, replied Sinbad. Well, all that's left of it, anyway. The gathered crowd all began to laugh. The King asked Sinbad to tell him more. Sinbad recounted his amazing story about his father's present, about his trip, about the giant fish, and about flying high up into the air and landing in the palm trees. The King was not sure whether to be impressed or not.
That's an amazingly fishy tale, he said.
That's just what Poisonous Pete said, sire, replied Sinbad.
Young man, said the King, you have a remarkable, if slightly dubious, ability to recognise boats. If you will stay here as my harbour lookout for the period of one calendar year, I will then grant you your freedom plus, a boat of your own choosing, complete with food and crew, so you can return home. What say you?
Sinbad readily agreed, and soon began possibly the favourite job of his entire career, ship spotting, for a living. He couldn't believe it. He was in heaven. Each day, a new set of ships. Each day, a new set of sketches and notes. He had a book second to none. When he got home, he'd be able to make a fortune touring the WI circuit with a PowerPoint slideshow of ships I have known, with numbers and sketches, everything. True to his word, the King granted Sinbad his freedom after a year. For his ship, Sinbad chose a Gulf Grand Charger with seven masts and a fancy modern mermaid carved onto the front. Soon, he was safe on his own shores once again. With the riches that the King had given him, he was able to buy himself a lovely palatial home with his own cooks and servants, and he vowed never to go on any more adventures ever again. Do you believe him? I'm Chris Eccleston, and that's the end of the story of Sinbad. Good night.